Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Presbyterian Church of Novato. We're glad that you're all here. We know that God has brought you here, and for that, we celebrate your presence with us today. Today, we're going into the second message of our sermon series, Simply Christian, to talk about the cross is its power. So as we go into worship today, our focus is going to be primarily on the cross. Don't forget to use your chat bar to lift up any prayer requests you have, and we will mention those a little bit later on in the worship service. Also, stick around after worship today, and we're going to be going over all these announcements in the life of the church so you know what's going on and how you can connect here in the life of the Presbyterian Church of Novato. My friends, we're so glad that you're here. Let us worship God this morning.
This morning. God, author of the story of life, we come to you this day gathered in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray that you open our hearts, our minds, and our lives to the redefining reality of the cross. Help us to see with fresh eyes how the cross changes everything. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we come before you, O God, we remember that we are not perfect, that we pull away from you time and time again. Let us confess our sins together. God of relentless love, we confess that we have often turned from you and wandered in our own wilderness of fear and doubt. Our thirst mounts daily, seeking to be quenched by your redeeming love. Yet when that love is offered to us, we again turn away, unable to truly believe that we would actually heal, that you would actually heal and love us. We have behaved in every unloving ways. We have chosen to ignore those in need or to deal only passively with them. Our hearts are not placed in service to others, but rather in self-serving motives. Heal us, merciful God. Show us again how the cross of Jesus changed our lives forever. Help us to be faithful servants. Amen. In Christ, mercy and healing are poured over you. God is loving and faithful. Those who come to God, come seek and loving presence to be healed. Amen.
My friends, again, welcome. Glad that you're in worship this morning. As you can see, my daughter and I are exchanging microphones back and forth as we have different parts of the liturgy pop up. And believe it or not, we work pretty well together, don't we, Katie? Mm-hmm. I paid her to say that. No, I'm just kidding. My friends, we're going to have something very special happen this morning. We're going to ordain and install new church officers in the life of the church, and we're going to do it virtually. That's right. I don't think I've ever done it this way in my life. So this will be the first time, and maybe it's the first time for you too. Now, there will be a part later on in this service when we are ordaining new officers where we usually do a laying on of the hands. Obviously, we cannot put our hands on anybody physically today, but what I'm going to invite you to do, elders and deacons, those who have been ordained before, when you're invited to lay on hands to those being ordained today, I invite you to just put your hand up like I am here and just hold it up to the camera like this for the duration of the prayer that will be for the ordination, and that will symbolize our laying on of hands today. Thank you, friends, for being accommodating in this.
We don't see you, Adam.
Or Katie.
Can you guys not see anything?
We see you.
I can see you.
Okay. Well, we're just going to keep going. If you can't see me, that's okay. But just when I get to that part, I'll make sure I'll lift it up and we can see your hands there. So let's go into this liturgy together. And I'm going to invite those who are being ordained and installed today to go ahead and just have your cameras on. And when I say, go ahead and unmute yourselves. And you should be able to do that for the ordination questions just a little bit later on. So that this morning, for those of you who don't know, it's going to be Regina Russ, Bob Clausen, and Linda Ward. Steve Revere was also going to be here today to be ordained and installed, but Steve's mother passed away this morning. So we will be praying for Steve's mom, and we'll be praying a little bit later on during our prayers of the people. So please keep Steve in your prayers. We also will have another person nominated and elected as an officer later on. And so we will do another ordination installation piece of liturgy later on in the next month or so. So don't worry, there will be more of this. All right, my friends. Let us hear our liturgy this morning. We are all called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. This is our common calling to be disciples and servants of our servant Lord Jesus Christ. Within the community of the church, some are called to particular service as deacons, elders, and ministers of word and sacrament. Ordination is Christ's gift to the church, assuring that his ministry continues among us, providing for ministries of caring and compassion in the world, ordering the governance of the church, and preaching the word and administering the sacraments. Representing the one holy Catholic and apostolic church, the session of the Presbyterian Church of Novato now ordains Regina Russ to the office of elder and installs her to active service. The Presbyterian Church of Novato also installs previously ordained officers, Bob Clausen as an elder, and Linda Ward as deacon, to active service on their respective boards. I have some short but profound questions for you all this morning. So if you would, go ahead and unmute yourselves. And we will ask these questions and I will prompt them for you this morning. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him, Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? If so, say, I do.
I do.
And do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? If so, say, I do and I will.
I do and I will.
Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? If so, say, I will.
I will.
And will you be governed by our church's polity? And will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? If so, say, I will.
I will.
And will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? If so, say, I will.
I will.
And do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? If so, say, I do. And will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? If so, say, I will. All right. And this question is for our deacons, for Linda. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, say, I will. And this question is for Bob and Regina, for elders. Will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you, if so, say, I will. All right. And this question is for the congregation. So all members of the church, you go ahead and you can stay muted for right now. We're going to do this while muted, but I have a question for you that we're going to answer aloud. Do we, the members of the church, accept these brothers and sisters as deacons and elders chosen by God through the voice of the congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? If so, say we do. Do we agree to encourage them to respect their decisions and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? If so, say, we do.
We do.
All right, and you can all be muted again if you are unmuted. All right, thank you for doing that. We're now going to do the laying on of hands for those being ordained, which would be Regina this morning. So what I want to invite you to do is to put your hand up in front of the screen, just like this, to symbolize that we are ordaining Regina to active service as an elder. All right, friends, let us pray this morning. Eternal God, we give you thanks for your steadfast faithfulness to us. In every age, you have called forth leaders to serve you and equip them with your gifts. Among your people, Israel, you anointed prophets, priests, and rulers. You called pastors, teachers, bishops, elders, and deacons to build up your church. In the church, deacons, elders, and pastors serve together so that your whole church might be equipped for ministry and built up into the full unity of Christ. God of grace, pour out your Holy Spirit on Regina, that she may be your faithful elder in the church. Give her prudence and sound judgment, wisdom and courage to order the life of the church in obedience to your word. Nourish her in the life of the Holy Spirit that she may exercise the ministry of discipline with humility and compassion. Guide her in governance on this session and in every court of the church, that she may be a servant leader following Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Give her joy in her walk of faith and sure sense of your abiding presence for her work of ministry. Amen. Friends, I'd like to congratulate and welcome Bob and Linda and Regina onto their respective boards this morning. Congratulations, and I am thrilled that you're going to be a part of this ministry with the church in leadership here at the Presbyterian Church of Novato. I think this church has elected very, very well, and you should all pat yourselves on the back this morning for God. We are blessed in Jesus Christ by their presence. So why don't you do an on-screen applause this morning? That's right, silent applause. I know it doesn't have the effect we'd like, but that's okay. We are thrilled you're here. And as I said before, we will have another election coming up soon for another deacon. And we will also have Steve and this person be ordained and installed in a later service. All right, my friends, thank you so much.
Hi, everybody. I have a collection here of crosses. There's a little purple wooden cross. I have a cross carved on a stone. Can you see that? Kind of cool. I have this kind of crazy, I think it's a cross. And I have a cross that my son made at camp out of leather. I got this cross in the mail from a really good friend. Isn't that beautiful? And I got this cross, which I love. See the jewels going around it? And I have this cross that I wear. I don't know if you can see it here all the time. Well, these crosses all represent and remind me of the big cross that Jesus had to carry. He suffered, and yet he still laid his life down for all of us. And crosses, as you can see here in our church, and the big one up on the wall, remind us that when we follow Jesus, it's not always easy. Our scripture today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18, the word of God. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but for us who are being saved, it is the power of God. So for those who don't believe, the cross doesn't make sense. But to us, it is the power of God. Whoa. We first learn about the cross in the Old Testament. Now, some of you are thinking, hold on a minute, Miss Sally. Jesus wasn't even born yet in the Old Testament. You're right. The Old Testament starts at the very beginning when God created heaven and earth and all the things that led up to the New Testament and Jesus' life. But his life was foretold, as well as his death, in the Old Testament. So, in the book of Isaiah, chapter 53, it describes how the Messiah would remain silent in the face of false accusations and would be beaten and mocked. And in chapter 50, the Savior would be hurt to save our sins. And by his wounds, we would be healed. And the prophet Daniel revealed that the Anointed One will be put to death and will have nothing. And that's in Daniel chapter 9. The Savior would die among criminals, Isaiah chapter 53, and people would gamble for his clothing in Psalm 22. The cross is a reminder of what Jesus willingly did. He knew exactly what was going to happen, and he did it anyway to pay for our mistakes forever. To give us a way to God, to make it possible to have a relationship with him. We are loved beyond measure. No matter what we've done, what we do, what we're going to do, or what we don't do, the cross represents a love foretold and talked about many years before it happened, an unconditional, forgiving, grace-filled love, a love the world does not understand and cannot give. Because of the cross, our debts have been paid, and we are free from sin. Let's pray. God, we thank you for sending your only Son to live and die for us, to willingly endure pain, to save us from our sin and make a way to you. Help us understand the greatness of the cross and help us to be patient when others do not. We pray for children everywhere that they will feel your love and hope. And during this time of abundant hurts and worries, help us lift them to you and know your abundant love overcomes all. In your precious Son's name we pray, and all God's children say, amen. See you later, guys.
Welcome back to our series, Simply Christian. This is our second week, and I'm glad that you're here. Whether you came to the first week or not, we're going to catch you up a little bit so you know what's going on. But what we're doing here is we're trying to dive in to the heart of Christianity, to find out what Christianity is all about. We're trying to get away from how Christianity has been defined in the public sphere, how it's been politicized and manipulated to become something that it's not. And we're trying to reboot and to reformat our hard drives, to clear out all the clutter and the messiness that's accumulated over time so that we can reinstall the necessary software, the heart of our faith again. And for those of you who have never been in the church before and really don't know a lot about Christianity other than what you see on TV, sorry about that. This is a great time to learn about what Christianity is really all about. And for those of us who have been in the church forever, this is a chance for renewal, to look at our faith again from a fresh perspective, to get down to the basics of who God is and who we are. So let's recap from last week, and I'll catch some of you guys up if you weren't here. Last week, we talked about Jesus. No surprise, I know. Because if we're honest with ourselves, in Christianity, it's all about Jesus. For Christians, Jesus we profess is God. That's a big profession, because we know Jesus was a human being, right? How could Jesus be God? And so we dug into that a little bit. Jesus, we talked about, was there before the beginning of all things in the cosmos. In fact, all things came into being through him and exist for Jesus. Jesus holds all things together. He's the key player in God's story of everything, including the one who is born as a human being to reconnect us with God. It's no secret that human beings are broken. You know that. I know that. We can't help but mess up. We can't help but do the wrong thing sometimes. Lying, cheating, stealing, being violent, going to war, and you know the list goes on and on. And God shows us that God's love for us is so much that God wants to be with us. So Jesus came into the world to show us that love for us, to die for our brokenness, the brokenness that we couldn't fix by ourselves, so that we could be together with God and with each other. So we could be at one. So in Christianity, it's all about Jesus. But today we're going to focus on a piece of Jesus' story. We're really going to focus on the turning point for all the cosmos. It's a part of that story that redefines my life and your life and shows us where God's story is ultimately leading. In Christianity, the cross is its power. What does that mean? Sounds a little nebulous, doesn't it? What is the cross? Well, you know what a cross is. You've seen the symbol everywhere, I'm sure. You've seen it perched atop church steeples. You've seen it on popular jewelry. You've seen it on bumper stickers. You might say that the cross is kind of a fashionable symbol around the world, and it's been a symbol that's been here for forever, since the dawn of Christianity. But what is the cross to Christians and to Christianity? Because it's more than just a beautiful symbol. For Christians, the cross represents a defining moment for all of humanity. In fact, for the entirety of creation, for all the cosmos, a defining moment. It's a moment that revealed the heart of who God is and what God thinks of you and me and all of us. And not only that, it's a moment where we learn who we are. We learn what we're called to be and to do. That's a pretty big moment, isn't it? It encapsulates all of everything, all of life even. In a sense, God's purpose in the cross is what we read in John's gospel in the third chapter, verses 16 and 17. So we're going to read that before we go any farther today. The text reads, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that anyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The cross is the symbol of God's rescue of us. We always use that word salvation, being saved, in the church, and it gets a little confusing sometimes. But it's the symbol of God rescuing us. The ultimate act revealing a God who, for some strange reason, cannot live without us and wants us to be with God. It shows this fierce, unwavering, and inexplicable love of a God who longs for nothing else in all of the creation of everything to be with us. God wants to rescue the world and humanity in it. But let's back up a minute. I feel like I'm jumping into this a little bit too quickly. What exactly is the history of cross? What are we talking about when we're talking about this moment that redefines everything, this crucial moment? What exactly is the history of the cross? Well, the story of the cross is not a pleasant one. The cross, prior to the birth of Christianity 2,000 years ago, was a symbol of Roman conquest and superiority. I mean, crucifixion was a death sentence for the worst of traitors, anybody who acted against the Roman Empire. People were bound or nailed to a piece of timber with a crossbar along the top, like a cross, right? It was a structure that would be raised vertically so that the person would hang from it on the weight of their wrists and their ankles, and the pain was excruciating, as was the inability to actually catch one's breath. The Romans had perfected torture, after all. They know what they're doing. The person would be left hanging on the cross, usually in some public place, because they're trying to serve as a warning to others, right? Don't go against Rome or this is going to happen to you. And after a huge amount of time, the person would finally die. Jesus would die this way, having upset the Jewish religious authorities, in a sense, threatening their power and their authority. And so they bring Jesus before the Roman authorities, falsely accusing him of sedition against Rome. And though the occupying Roman governor couldn't find credibility in these accusations, he eventually capitulates under pressure. And Jesus, who is innocent and blameless, is crucified. Here's a man who lived his whole life, showing humanity the nature of God's love for us. And he would be killed because it threatened the ways of the world. It threatened the ways of domineering power and greed and selfishness, manipulation, exploitation, racism, discrimination. I mean, the list goes on and on. These things that Jesus stood against, offering a new way. And the world would kill him for it. But this death wasn't just any death. Jesus had been preparing his disciples for this death. Jesus knew he was going to die. Jesus knew the things he was saying and preaching and teaching. He knew this would eventually lead to somebody killing him, to him dying. And he lets his disciples know, leading them to this moment, letting them know that this would be his end. And for us and his disciples, death is the end, right? There is nothing after death. But here it's going to be different. This death would be necessary in order to save an undeserving humanity. Now from here, things begin to become a little challenging as we talk about the cross. Jesus is executed and he dies. And then somehow, 3 days later, he appears alive again. How could this happen? What exactly happened? Oh, that's the question. And I think it's important that we pause here for a minute and simply confess this is what happened. This account is corroborated by eyewitness testimony. And it's an account that is fully mysterious and miraculous and inexplicable. What happened? How could this happen? At this point, we could dive into any number of the atonement theories out there, and I'm sure you know some of those if you were in the church. And for those of you who did not grow up in the church, atonement is a big theological word that literally means at one, atone, right? At one meant with God. Somehow in the cross, we confess that we are made one, brought together with God. And there's all sorts of theories out there and theological rationale for how this happened and why this happened. There's all these atonement theories out there. There's the ransom theory and the satisfaction theory. And then there's the penal substitution theory. All of these different theories out there to describe what happened at the cross in Jesus' death. To get at the question of how we are rescued and how we are saved and brought at one with God. But the truth is, we don't fully understand the how question. And that's okay. That's one thing that should be said about Christians, is that we're not beyond asking questions. That we don't have every single answer out there, and we never profess to. We don't know the mechanism that God uses for what God's doing here, but it happens. Christianity is not so much interested with the how question, but more the so what question. What does this have to do with anything? So I want to think about that for a minute, and I want to pull away from those atonement theories and maybe come at this from a different angle, maybe one that makes more sense to some of us. Now, one of my favorite seasons is the fall. I know there's only four of them, but I love the fall because I love the rich tapestry of the colors that take over the landscape. In Iowa, we had at our house, we had these giant trees outside, and they would just turn into bright yellows and bright reds, and these vibrant browns even. And at some point, the leaves would fall off the trees and create this carpet along the ground that I thought was incredible. It was almost like they were rolling out the special carpet as I went to work in the morning. As long as I blocked out that I would eventually have to rake those up, it was beautiful. It was amazing. But really and truly, these beautiful leaves are, in a sense, they're dying, right? They're falling to the earth, never to find their way back onto the branches. And yet without this death, there might not be life. You see, the fall season, in a sense, is already preparing for the spring. That organic material that falls into the earth and fertilizes and enriches the soil is readying it for the new life that is to come. In a sense, this image helps give us an idea of what we see at the cross and to make sense of what happens on the cross. Jesus' death, which is really only fully given meaning in resurrection, which we'll talk about later on, reveals to the world that there is life to come. That death in this world is not the end, like we typically think of death. All of a sudden, Jesus changes something. He changes the code, right? We've been using this rebooting, reformatting imagery. It's like he reprograms things. He changes the code. Changes that one reality that we all know so well, that death has the last word, that death is final. But now, we see something unexpected and miraculous. Death giving way to life. In a sense, Jesus' death prepares us for the spring that is to come. In the Apostle Paul's letter to the Roman church, he writes this about the cross. He writes, "While we were still weak, at the right moment, Christ died for ungodly people." It isn't often that someone will die for a righteous person, though maybe someone might dare to die for a good person. But God shows his love for us because while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So now that we have been made righteous by his blood, we can be even more certain that we will be saved from God's wrath through him. Jesus' death and resurrection, this cross symbol, brought us life beyond death, rescuing us from our own sinful nature that we couldn't figure out how to fix on our own. And we still can't today. And in so doing, redefined our lives now. If sin and death don't hold power over us anymore, then we are free to be truly us. Think about it with me. If the weight of our brokenness is taken away, which is a heavy weight, friends, how much does that free us to be truly us? To be who we were created to be all along, to be the very good creation of God, to be the caretakers of God's good creation, free to live for Jesus. Because if you remember last week, as we talked about it's all about Jesus, we talked about being created for Jesus, that is part of our purpose as human beings, as children of God. In Christianity, the cross is its power. The cross symbolizes the death of that which separates us from God, sin, and the new life that we have now and forever in Jesus Christ. Freedom to be our true selves. Hope for tomorrow and today. Knowledge of this crazy, reckless love of God that we call grace. And a way of life that's grounded in that grace. I know, pause for a minute. There's a lot wrapped up into this one symbol, this cross. It's where the power of Christianity is. It reshapes and gives meaning to the whole of God's story. That epic narrative of which we are a part. That God would love us so much that God would die for us so that we might live. It shows us that the ultimate end of things is not death, it's new life. And to most of the world, this sounds kind of ridiculous, right? God's act looks foolish. It looks like weakness. It's not the actions of a powerful God. But to me, and maybe it's true for you too, it's that part of the story that seems to echo truth, isn't it? That we find so alluring and so magnetic that just draws us in. This inexplicable love that we long and hope for that stands in the face of the present powers of this world. There's this brokenness in the world, in the ways of the world, that we want to fix. Look at our political system right now. There are things we want to fix. We want to be together. We want to be united, and we can't figure it out. We want to fix it, but just can't seem to do it no matter what. And that's the history of the human race too, isn't it? We want justice. We want things to be made right. And no matter how hard we try, we can't seem to get there. We want it. We desperately need it. And this story in the cross, in the death and resurrection of Jesus, gives us the missing piece. The part that we long for, that begins to make things right. There's something about this grace that we can't seem to ignore, about things being put to rights by a God whose love for us is absolute and relentless even. This cross makes life possible. Everlasting life, absolutely, but life today too. It's the turning point that changes the course of history, that points to where God is going with his plan, with everything that's going on, towards a renewed heavens and an earth that are to come when God puts all things to rights. And so for Christians, we live every day in gratitude for what Jesus has done for us. And we seek to turn away from sin and from those ways of the world that pull us away from God's way. And instead, we move towards Jesus. And I have to tell you, it's not easy. But we rest assured in the cross that this new life is possible. That the risen Christ is still with us today, walking with us through the Holy Spirit, still making up for where we fall short, filling us with new life over and over and over again. In Christianity, the cross is its power. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
As we continue in worship, let us go to God in prayer. Jesus, author of life, author of love, Lord, Savior, and friend, reveal within us, our hearts and minds, who you are and what you are all about. Let us see your unique and life-giving love again and again in our broken and fearful world. Let our spiritual questions find answers in you. Show us again and again the meaning of the cross and how it has changed our lives forever. Teach us to connect and build relationships with our neighbors. Fill us with such grace that we cannot help but share about you in all that we do and say. Today, we pray for our nation, that we pray that anger calms, the violence ceases, the division, divisive rhetoric, and lies and put to an end. We pray for integrity and of our democracy, for our stewardship of it, and hope that we can and will do a better together. We pray that all begin to take the necessary steps to pull away from the toxic narratives of which we're a part, instead choose to live into your epic narrative, where grace and love are ways of being. We pray that we continue to look to Jesus as our guide, our example, the fullness of what humanity can be. We pray that love, compassion, humility, honesty, and servanthood are reflected in us in our communities. We also look beyond our borders and pray on behalf of all people from every nation around the world, for the lost and the lonely, for the hurting and the suffering, for the sick and the dying, for the poor and the lowly. We pray for your healing and wholeness. We pray for the hungry that they be fed, the thirsty that they may have something to drink, the homeless that they be housed, the victims of injustice, racism, discrimination, violence, and hate. We pray for your justice, love, and peace. We pray that the new vaccines will end this pandemic. We pray for distribution to be hastened, that so that we can begin to be with one another again. We long for hugs, for gatherings, and companionship. We are social beings missing a piece of ourselves. Help us be patient just a little longer, keeping one another safe. We pray for unity in the midst of division, oneness in your love. Show us how to be civil, compassionate, and loving. Bring us together in authentic community. Build bridges of hope and teach us to live in peace together. Today, we pray for our congregation at PCN, lifting up those prayer requests that we have ourselves received this morning.
Merciful God, you give us grace that helps us always and especially in times of need. Many of us grieve, Father, and today we pray for the Revere family on the passing of Steve's mother this morning. May our love and prayers surround them during this time. For the family and friends of the Reverend Clayton Cobb, who passed away unexpectedly on January 2nd, he was our pastor after Don Remont and before Kent Weber. We pray for the Tarkman family on the passing of Mike's mother, Patricia John. We pray for the friends and family of Sally James, who passed on December 28th. For the DeQuisto family on the passing of Larry Sr. and Larry's older brother, Emilio, on December 22nd. We ask for continued strength and comfort for the entire Mink family. May our love and prayers surround all of them during this time. God of compassion and sorrow, we receive from you the comfort you alone can give. Enable us to see that you are always working for our good. You are our dwelling place, O God. And underneath us all are your everlasting arms. Assure us of your love that we may be able to accept what we cannot understand. Lord of peace, be with all who are grieving. We lift up those who are in frail health or struggling with chronic illnesses. We lift Annie Schneeflock and her family, for Don Coleman and Sherry Mansfield facing surgery, for Philip Brott in the hospital with COVID and his wife and son at home with COVID, John and Stacy Bischoff, Elaine Scott, the Shanahan's son-in-law, and for all those battling with COVID, Father. For those who are recovering from surgery, Dewey Blair, Joe Crawley, Linda Isley, Brenda McIver, Tony McMicken, Heidi Shearer, Ed Tank, and Jay Wayne. We lift Larry DeQuisto Jr., Jim and Melody Baird, Candy Blomquist, Mickey Deaton, Lisa Lee, Diane Scott, and her son-in-law, Jarek, and mother Janet. We lift Becca Lee, who is struggling with lightheadedness. Help her find relief. For those who are caring for family and friends, we pray for all our caregivers, Father. Be with them as they care for those who are not able to care for themselves. As roles are switched, as partners and loved ones experience health issues, give them strength to endure and comfort. We pray for all who are on our concerns list. May they be uplifted by our prayers and thoughts and feel your presence. For those struggling with the darkness of depression, give them hope. Jesus, you are the great physician. May your healing hands touch both body and heart to restore those who are suffering. God, there is so much to pray for, and we are grateful that you know our needs better than we know them ourselves. We pray the prayers that are unspoken and known only to you for those of us and those we know who battle each day. Help us all to know you are with us, and nothing is too great for us to overcome with your help. We pray for Joe Robinson aboard the USS Nimitz, who days before a much-needed leave was returned back to the Iranian waters. Give us all the power of your Holy Spirit as we live into these times of great uncertainty. Jesus, even as we come to you with prayers of burden and concern, so too do we come to you with prayers of praise and thanksgiving. We praise you for all of our PCUSA missionaries as they strive to reach people in other nations with your love and word. We praise you for Jeff Pinar and Juarez, his love and care for the orphans and families. Keep him safe. And we praise you for our staff, our committees, as they respond to budget decisions and plan for 2021. For the deacons as they care for our entire congregation, for our elders and Stephen ministers, we give you the glory for all we've been able to accomplish and all you will have us do in the coming months. Help us to follow your will. And as our nation struggles, encourage us to stand apart and not be drawn by sides. Help us to be a part of the healing process. We are your church, Father, and we thank you for all our amazing blessings. May we rise to the challenges we face, setting an example and being a beacon for others to see you. Oh God, receive all these our prayers.
Oh God, hear all these prayers. Teach us to listen for the answers. Oh God, we pray all these things in your name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I no longer a slave to
I am.
I want to thank you all for being here this morning. If you take anything from the service today, remember in Christianity, the cross is its power. It's that defining moment where everything changes, where everything is made to rights in Jesus Christ. Friends, in the church, we don't have all the answers. But we have God and we have Jesus Christ, who shows us that we are loved beyond anything for some strange reason. And even though we screw up all the time, and we do, God is there to bring us together again because of the cross, because of Jesus. Amen to that. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.